almost there. I certainly want to wait for President Akhtasari, so if anybody... Does anyone know if he's coming now or... Well, welcome back. My name is Mike Holtzel, and if my nagging cough holds off, it'll be my pleasure and honor to serve as chair of this roundtable discussion, which has already been described as dynamic, so we'll try to be dynamic.
Of course.
The theme is leadership and problem solving in an unstable world, and President Akhtasari so masterfully laid out some of the parameters in his keynote remarks, in which he stressed the essential nature of the transatlantic relationship and the common ideals that bind us. We have a stellar group of panelists here today: James Goodby, former U.S. Ambassador to Finland; Ilkka Ruohtinen, president, I just promoted you.
Okay, thank you.
I'm not sure you'd want that as a promotion, having been a college vice president. I'm not sure you want that. Professor of political science at the University of Tampere, and Karen Erickson, who is a dean of the School of Arts and Sciences of Southern New Hampshire University. Their professional accomplishments are many and varied and most impressive and are outlined in the symposium program. I'm not going to take up time right now to read them. I actually clearly called the meeting to order a little bit too early. I'm going to wait for just a minute or two until the rest of the people come in. Calling for 15-minute coffee breaks is an exercise in extreme optimism. President Akhtasari, in his remarks, concentrated on American leadership. I have to say I'm flattered and humbled by that as an American, and also on changes here. I'm sure we'll return to this theme, but at the outset, I'd like to refocus the discussion on Finland. Stability has been the hallmark of Finnish politics and society for decades. Finns are solid in the best sense of the word. I find it an immensely appealing personal and national characteristic that has served the country well. Time and again, Finland has proven to be resilient in the face of classical economic and political difficulties. What gives me pause, however, is whether Finland's society and body politic have the flexibility to adapt to the totally new challenges they will likely be facing in the prevailing international order and domestically. Obviously, I'm saying this under the influence of events in this country that nearly no one foresaw even 1 year ago. As a sometime political scientist, I would ask the rhetorical question, are countries with Westminster parliamentary systems more immune to the kind of digitally fueled populism that enabled Donald Trump to exploit the holes in the idiosyncratic U.S. electoral system? And as we heard earlier, the recent experiences of Hungary, Poland, and I would add Slovakia don't inspire much hope. But as we also heard earlier, the recent elections in the Netherlands showed at least a partial rejection of xenophobia and ultranationalism. I suspect that, like me, many of you are holding your breath before the upcoming election next month in France and the election in Germany in September, to which President Akhtasari also referred. Are Finns, who until now seemed to trust their political leaders, susceptible to an so-called alternative fact mindset where whatever one doesn't like can be labeled fake news? Or how about what I would call real fake news? Finnish officials claim to have documented 20 different disinformation campaigns against their country that have come directly from the Kremlin. The case of Jessica Aro, an investigative journalist for the social media division of Finland's state broadcaster Yle Kioski, is instructive. In 2014, Ms. Aro followed up on reports of a Russian troll factory in St. Petersburg that was seeking to influence public opinion in the West about Kremlin maneuvers abroad. After she published her initial investigation, which documented how pro-Russian voices were attempting to shape the public discourse in Finland on Ukraine, her name appeared on Russian nationalist websites, where she was derided as a Western intelligence agent, and she was bombarded with anonymous and abusive messages on social media calling her a drug dealer and worse. Perhaps under the, as a reaction to that and other incidents, in October of 2015, President Sauli Niinistö publicly acknowledged that information warfare is real for Finland. And he said that it was the duty of every citizen to combat it. In January 2016, the Prime Minister's office enrolled 100 officials in a program across several levels of the Finnish government to identify and understand the spread of disinformation. Friends of Finland, I count myself in that category, hope that the combination of widespread critical thinking skills among the well-educated Finnish population and this coherent government response will forge an effective defense against concerted outside efforts to skew reality and undermine faith in institutions. Now, Finland has earned a well-earned reputation for understanding Russia. Yet I think we have to admit that nearly all Finns were blindsided last year by the Kremlin's sudden opening of its state border to allow migrants into Finland. It happened last winter. High-level personal diplomacy actually solved that issue at least temporarily, but it strikes me as a warning signal. It's a pretty weak reed to lead on. So how then does Finland cope with a changing international security situation? I couldn't agree more with President Ahtisaari of the need for soft power, conflict mediation, peacekeeping, peace enforcement. They're key. I think the proposed budget for the United States for next year, cutting almost 29% from the State Department, most of it coming out of USAID, is exactly the wrong thing to do, but there we are. Nonetheless, I think hard power still matters, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. NATO membership. Someone asked the question, and President Ahtisaari answered it. It reminded me of my days back here at the Woodrow Wilson Center. If Sam Wells is still here, I didn't see him at the coffee break, but way back in 1986, when we were over at the Smithsonian Castle, we held a remarkable conference on Spain. Felipe González, the Prime Minister, came to the conference and he brought essentially his entire cabinet. Now, if you think that opposition to NATO membership is strong in Finland, you can't imagine what it was like in Spain. And it was headed by, earlier, the head of the Socialist Party, Felipe González. Funny thing happens when you get responsibility. You wake up to a variety of hard realities, and in his case, they formed an ethical argument. And I'll never forget, Felipe González, this gigantic opponent of NATO membership, explained to the people at the Wilson Center why he thought it was essential for Spain to apply for membership to NATO. And this was before a national referendum. And it boiled down to an ethical, if you will, even a moral question. He said, we've joined the West. We've joined what was the European community at the time. We get a lot of benefits from that. But with benefits go responsibilities. And I've come to realize that one of those responsibilities is to defend this order that we're joining. It was a remarkable speech. And actually, in the referendum, as we all know, Spain, to the surprise of many people, voted to join NATO. I've always believed that NATO membership was in Finland's interest, but this friendly advice looks shakier these days with the U.S. president, who on a good day doesn't understand the alliance and on a bad day thinks it's obsolete. So upon What should Finland base its future hard security? Nordefco? Hardly. Some kind of a beefed up Nordefco plus a post EU United Kingdom? Well, without the US nuclear and conventional umbrella, it's hard for me to see that structure as a credible deterrent. I hope at least some of the panelists will grapple with these and other questions. I'm asking each of them to speak for approximately 15 minutes. Then we'll have some time for intra-panel discussion, followed by questions from our audience and a very short wrap-up. Let me briefly preview our three panelists' contribution. I'd like to begin with Ambassador Goodby. Jim, you're a security expert. Among other things, I hope you will address some of the points I just mentioned. Before you do, I'd like you to, again briefly, set the historical context for us. I know that an issue that especially interests you is whether there was a discontinuity in Finnish foreign policy after the departure of President Kekkonen. Did his Cold War leadership style and principles gradually fade away when the Cold War ended? More specifically, did President Koivisto, with whom you dealt, represent more of a break with the past than he's often credited with? And if you still have time after doing all that, perhaps you could say a word or two about how globalization and new technologies have changed the concept of security. Karen, you have written, and Ambassador Kauppi has underscored this afternoon, that Finland and all other small countries depend on the international order to provide the security and stability that they can't on their own achieve in this incredibly complex and unstable world. And they also have a role to restrain great powers from being more foolhardy than they often are already. That's a difficult job. Finland, as I said earlier, has met the test for almost 100 years. But to use an old Soviet term, the correlation of forces, is today's correlation of forces sufficiently different from the past that would mean that the wisdom of leaders of small powers counts for less? And then finally, Ilkka, continuing on this leadership track, is going to analyze modern Finnish political culture in an international perspective by comparing the political elites in the United States and Finland. Now, jumping ahead real quickly, because I'm likely to forget to say it later, we will have a Q&A period. As I said, when I call upon you, please wait until you get the microphone. Give us your name, rank, and serial number, as they say, any institutional affiliation you have. And then finally, and we'll try to get this over by 5 o'clock, there will be a reception in the Moynihan Room, which is, I believe, right across the hall, and you're all cordially invited. So with that, let me give the floor to my friend, Ambassador Jim Goodby.
Thank you, Mike. I think I'll sit here because I have a lot of papers strewn around here I may refer to. I want to give you a reading assignment, first of all, because this document I'm about to mention to you answers a lot of the questions that Mike raised, and I would think would give you a great deal of confidence in the ability of Finland to adapt and react to circumstances as they occur. It's a document published by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Finland, and it's called The Effects of Finland's Possible NATO Membership, an Assessment. And it goes back into history, and it gives, I think, a very clear-eyed analysis of exactly where Finland stands right now, what the pros and cons of NATO membership are, what the strategic environment is, what the kinds of issues are that need to be addressed, very clear-eyed about Russia's reaction to NATO membership, and I think if you all do nothing else as a result of coming to this, if you read that, I think you will be very, very well informed about these issues. About the question of NATO membership, I won't say anything more. I'm not plugging it one way or the other, but it is pretty clear that Finland understands that this is a challenging decision that has to be made. The conclusion that this particular group came to, I think, is that Sweden and Finland should join together, if they join at all. There are reasons that they argue as to why one country should not go in without the other. They make a pretty good case that in some circumstances that The possibility of reactions from Russia would be pretty violent. But they look at this without fear or favor, I think, and it's a really very, very good analysis, in my view. Let me just tell you, I was in Finland as ambassador during the time of Kekkonen. President Kekkonen was seen as a man who was close to Moscow. They helped him, apparently, with his election campaigns. At the same time, I think Kekkonen gets a lot of credit for supervising or presiding over, I guess is a better way to put it, Finland's integration, really, into the Western world in terms of economics. Finland was always a part of the Western world, I think you can say. This was something that I think was more or less inevitable, but it happened because Kekkonen maintained a relationship with Moscow that made Finland, made it possible for Finland to do things that other countries might not have been able to do. One of his sayings was, the closer we are to the east, the closer we can be to the west. And I think that's probably the way a lot of Finns saw it. At least it seemed to me that's the way it looked. People complained about too much self-censorship. I think there was perhaps a bit of that as far as the newspapers were concerned. But on the whole, Finland, I think, did as well as it could do under those circumstances. I knew President, a man who became president, Mauno Koivisto, not as president, but as I think he was prime minister at the time. I was about ready to go. I had a lot of conversations with him, and I was struck by his independence of thought, his willingness to think freely about things. Towards the end of my stay there, he got into a big fight with President Kekkonen, and I went to see him shortly thereafter. I frankly don't recall what the fight was about now. It had something to do with some internal business, I think. And he said, you know, I'm a dead man. They can't do anything more to me. I mean, this is the way he felt, having run into a buzzsaw when he was apparently challenging President Kekkonen over a major issue. But he had a very clear view in his mind about what Finland was, where it was, and what it ought to be. And so when the time came for him to become president, he took a lot of steps that I think moved rather quickly to get Finland back into the Western world in a way that I think is now locked in concrete, if you will. So did Finland adapt to these changed circumstances? Was the leadership there? Yes, it was there during the Cold War. It was there when the Cold War ended. And I don't need to mention what President Ahtisaari did to further that. So I think the leadership is there. I take a little exception to people who sort of think about small countries as somehow, you know, not able to play a major role in world affairs. I think the Winter War certainly was a profound experience for everybody, including people in the United States. But it wasn't the Winter War that made Finland what it is. It was Finnish diplomacy. It seems to me that Finnish diplomacy throughout the Cold War and now has been the linchpin of what has brought Finland so much success economically as well as other ways. So small countries, in fact, now, I want to shift a little bit into technology that Mike also raised. Technology now is, I think, what we used to call the great equalizer. The great equalizer used to be the atomic bomb, made all countries equal because it was tremendously powerful. Now I think the great equalizer is the internet, all the things that go with that, I sometimes equate countries that I'm somewhat familiar with at opposite ends of Eurasia, Korea and Finland. As small countries, they've achieved a great deal in somewhat similar ways. Each country doesn't like that comparison, but I've discovered, it is a fact that they both understand technology, know how to deal with it. And it makes them not just a small power, but a big power in the world we're moving into now. The world we're moving into now has a lot of geopolitical content to it. And clearly the issues that we are facing in Europe over Putin's actions in Ukraine and annexation of Crimea, not to mention the overflights we were talking about and all the other threatening kinds of activities, this shows you that the geopolitical component of foreign policy is still there in a very big way, can't be ignored. But there are a set of new things coming along already with us, not, I shouldn't say coming along, they're already here, by which I mean the impact on international relations and on society of technology. Mike alluded to that. I think it's had an even more profound effect than we sometimes realize. In the United States, for example, I think it has made the exercise of representative democracy harder than it used to be. And I hark back to Federalist Paper number 10, which is written by James Madison. And Madison, in that Federalist Paper, warned about what he called pure democracy, or what we might call participatory or direct democracy. He thought it would cause factions to arise and make it difficult to govern. He was in favor of what we call today representative government. What the internet has done is make direct democracy more feasible than it ever has been throughout history, at least for a country of our size. And in turn, that has, I think, undermined some of the ability of the United States to govern in accordance with the principles that the founders had in mind. So I think we need to consider very carefully how the digital age is affecting our internal systems. We need also to consider how it affects international security, because it's clear from things we've already said, Mike mentioned some of them, we have trolls, we have hacking, we have fake news, we have the whole gamut of things that are there now and need to be addressed in some way. I know Finland and the Nordic countries are thinking about this, but I think it's not enough just to think in terms of our traditional institutions like NATO and the European Union and their traditional roles. I think somehow or other we have to get into the mainstream agenda of the Western world, if you will, how one deals with this new threat, I could say, challenge, perhaps a better word. And I think it's important for us to do that without any further delay. Globalization also, I don't think Mike mentioned that, but I would say that that also has its challenges. It may well be that globalization has reached a zenith as of now, because technology itself is making labor costs less and making it less attractive for the United States and other countries to ship their factories overseas. And now you can do a lot of things and will be able to do a lot of things with robotics and artificial intelligence, 3D printing and that sort of thing, so that the incentives to have overseas investments in the United States, I think, will be somewhat less than they are now. So globalization, however, is going to be a problem in the sense that we, I think, have ignored the effects that it has had also on society, because you clearly Brexit is one of those results of the backlash that people are seeing around in the world, in Europe and also in the United States. So how we do this, I think, presents us very interesting problems in governance, in terms of the balance between labor, capital, and so forth, how people represent themselves to their decision makers and that sort of thing. So a lot of work is going to be needed in that area. Let me just say a few words. I think I'm running out of time, am I? Okay. I think that a country like Finland can offer the world a tremendous service by helping us, and when I say us, I mean the United States, understand some of these issues that I've just been talking about. You all recall, of course, that Molotov's view was that the era of small nations is ending. My sense is that the era of small nations may be just beginning. Globalization has had an effect not only of integration, but also of creating divisions, fractionation, if you will, of countries. Look at Scotland, look at Catalonia, look at what's happening around Europe, and to some extent in the United States. And you find that the effect on the way countries think and react is really quite startling. Finland, I think, can teach us quite a bit in the way it conducts its democracy. I was impressed by it when I was there. I am still. And Finland is, frankly, one of the leading countries in the world in how one practices these new instruments that have come to the fore. So I would look to Finland really as not as a small country in Northern Europe, but as one of the major players in the world that's now emerging. And I think we can probably learn quite a bit if we work together in this area. That's just what I'm pleading now, that we talk about NATO, we talk about the EU, but these, in a sense, have been reacting to issues that are still with us, but are issues that we're fairly familiar with. We're talking now about issues that we're not at all familiar with, and we need have a lot of help from Finland especially. Thanks.
I think I'll travel.
Okay, good.
Ambassador Goodby has related Finland to the world, and I think I might relate the world to Finland. And so I would like to start with the topic that we are addressing in this on this panel, which has to do with leadership and problem solving in an unstable world. Taking things literally, as I sometimes do, I'm going to look at problem solving, the concept of leadership, and the relationship of leadership to the context of transatlantic relations and entire meaning of an unstable world. Things are unstable when they don't go your way, or unstable when you can't really find some reasonable way to explain how to fix them or what is happening. Certainly, we have a litany of things not going our way in today's time of troubles that ranges from transgressions of global norms to questions of the survival of the liberal international order, or the very survival of the West, as many have referred to it. And last month, Senator John McCain put in important relief form when he raised the question at Munich Security Conference. So what is the context today of transatlantic relations? Where are transatlantic relations? From Svalbard to Sudan, maybe? In the context of handling transatlantic relations, do we assume an East-West divide as a basic approach to international politics, which the Cold War, certainly with its bifurcation between the US and Soviet Union, did seem to assume? Or do we assume a North-South contextual divide as civil strife, refugee movements, starvation, pandemics, genocide, and generally irrepressible violence hit hard in the post-Cold War era? Finally, looking at these terms, what is the basic structure of an unstable world? Is it one in disarray, or is it one of national insecurity? You'll immediately recognize the reference to Richard Hawes's book on the world in disarray, that is, one that is nonpolar, with the distribution of power among multivariate actors both state and non-state, any world that has a crumbling facade because of disregard for post-Westphalian rules of play. If the trouble is not in the international system, does it lie then in national insecurity, as David Rothkopf's work contends? He says, and I quote, "We have come to realize that the greatest threats America faces are in fact here at home." Putting the two ideas together, I come up with the question, how do internal insecurities affect global disarray? Populism, authoritarianism, despotism, chaos, and yes, stable democracy in national contexts, what do they mean when projected onto the global scene? I contend that leadership is key to problem solving in an unstable world. In a talk in London last week, a longtime observer of international affairs, Ken Booth, said, and I quote, "In this time of fear, anger, and unreason, the world seems short of enlightened leadership." Discourses of populism, complacency, neoliberalism, and global citizenship vie with each other. In a book that demonstrates the relationship between 20th century American presidential leadership and international consequences, Joseph Nye asks, and I quote, "If we look at the leadership, or if we took the leadership variable away, would America still have come to exercise primacy in international politics?" It is, of course, a rhetorical question, and he spends the rest of the book answering no. National political leadership is so significant that the Foreign Affairs this month has spent the entire issue on the five-letter word, Trump. Concentrating on the first two decades of the 21st century, Rothkopf portends that one of the really great obstacles to meeting America's international challenges going forward will be to find a way to restore an effective working partnership between the White House and the Congress and between Republicans and Democrats. The enduring nature of internal partisan division and its effects on foreign affairs was arguably also the major concern of America's first president. Discussing party dissension, George Washington warned, it always serves to distract. It agitates the community with ill-founded jealousies and false alarms, kindles the animosity of one part against another. It opens the door to foreign influence and corruption, which finds a facilitated access to the government itself through the channels of party passions. Thus, the policy and the will of one country are subjected to the policy and will of another 220 years ago. Leadership of and by a great power leaves open the question, where do small countries fit into the picture if leadership is key to problem solving in an unstable world? And I agree with Ambassador Goodby that small countries have a major role to play. Small countries may take part in prevention and response related to global crises and conflicts. They may undertake the sovereign obligation and not to let bad things happen. But will they do so? Will they take on the role? What makes these small countries good citizens of the world? Deceivingly simple, the answer is they've been raised well. At least some of them. There's no substitute for strong traditions of civil society in the life of the commons, and no substitute for understanding norms of right and wrong in the life of the individual. The character and enduring nature of a people become emblazoned and embedded in the leadership. It is the national political tradition they maintain that is the crucial factor in determining the nature of the elites in any one country. This is a quotation from a book written 50 years ago by some erstwhile political scientists. The book was called France, Germany, and the Western Alliance. seminal work on elites done 65 years ago concluded leadership of a society is a criterion of the values by which society lives, the well-known Laswell and Lerner team. Nowhere is there a better example of how the beliefs, attitudes, and values of a political leadership affect the internal stability to survive and external capacity to stabilize relations with all the world's powers than Finland. My assumption is that leadership reflects or represents, or guides, cajoles, or forces mindsets of the people. And it characterizes a country and its culture at any particular time. I began a project in 1959 that I called Finnish Political Culture that ended up with real-time interviews of 264 Finnish political leaders that I conducted between January and June of 1960. The 264 political leaders actually represented 291 different positions. Some were doubly booked, as for example, Prime Minister Fagerholm at the time was a representative in the parliament, but also head of the National Liquor Control Board, as an example. But the leadership that I looked at came from very many different walks of society. They were certainly the parliament. I interviewed 185 of the 200 Finnish parliamentarians. They were the cabinet, the president, President Kekkonen, with whom I spent a little over 2 hours interviewing at the time in the spring of 1960. It included the judiciary, and then it included the whole realm of institutional leaders, the press, the economic interest groups, labor, agriculture, owners of the state enterprises. It included many different parts of local administration, even though Finland is a centralized government. What I asked, of course, were many questions, but questions that got at the heart of what people think. Because my idea at the time was that certainly, and no systematic study had been made up to that time of the relationship between belief and behavior, between what it is that an individual leader values and how an individual leader votes or decides. What is that relationship? And what I found looking, let's say, for example, only at the parliamentarians, was that the cleavage among the parliamentarians based on the action lines of political parties was not the same kind of cleavage or divisions that I found when I analyzed the answers that they gave to the 50 open-ended questions that I asked that had to do with getting at their beliefs, attitudes, and values. I also found that there was not a particularly solid relationship between belonging to any particular leadership group, belonging to a political party, or age. Values and attitudes and beliefs crossed these normal lines of analysis when you try to correlate what is happening within the realm of a political culture. Let me give you some examples of the questions that I asked. As I said, these were 50 open-ended questions. Well, that's great. 50 open-ended questions. I interviewed the political the 264 liters in Finnish, and which was much better then than it is now. But here are 10 of the 50 questions. What are the most important functions of the state? In your view, what should be the most important domestic and foreign policy goals? What are currently the most important functions of political parties? Do political leaders in Finland have too much or too little personal influence? What's the most important, trust in the leadership or trust in the system? Which conflicts and differences of opinion are the most serious in Finnish political life? Rank the following values in order of importance to preserving the existing political system. Which is more important for the survival of the Finnish state, to increase the national income to the highest possible level or to distribute the national income as equally as possible? Is the happiness and welfare of the individual an end in itself, or is the individual's main obligation to serve society? Which of the following do you consider more important? Certainty that the government will not interfere in the work and life of the individual, or social security and well-being? Now, I just, certainly will go in another venue into detail here, but I have some interesting answers, which probably serves as anecdotal information from some of the people I interviewed. Let's look at the question of values. Rank the following values in order of their importance to preserving the existing political system. While President Kekkonen did not want to commit to any rank order and didn't mark those values, he said that he would have, if he were marking these, ranking them, he said he would have marked justice as having the highest priority, and he guessed that most people whom I interviewed of the leadership would put tolerance and individualism last. Now, you'll have to come back for future attractions to find out which of these values wins, which loses, and who said what. I also found that in the course of the interviews, people like someone who became very big in Finnish politics, Ahti Karjalainen, not at that point, but was up and coming, said that the Finns are honorable, upright, righteous, and principled people. Now, in answer to the question of which is more important to the survival of the Finnish state, increase the national income, or distribute the income as equally as possible, Hertta Kuusinen, who led the Communist Party at the time, said, "I cannot put these into a priority arrangement, but rather we need a little of each. If we increase the level of income, it will raise the level of welfare for the whole nation." I also thought her answer on the question of which is more important, the individual or society, individual as an end in itself, or the individual's, is the individual's obligation mainly to society, Hertta Kuusinen again said that these two ideas are interactive. "I do not give much value to the society that does not care about the individual at all. If society takes care of the individual, then the individual should give back to society." These cut across political lines, but give some indication of the values, beliefs, and attitudes that make up the backbone of a small nation that in turn allows it to make a great contribution to the values, attitude, and beliefs of a more stable world.
Thank you, Karen. Thanks very much. Ilkka, last but not
least. Okay, thank you, Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen. Karen told about Finnish political culture in 1960. However, I will focus on Finnish modern political culture in comparative perspective and compare US and the Finnish Finland in terms of top-level political leadership. And political culture can be defined as a result of fundamental values, attitudes, and knowledge among the elites and the citizenry, which gives the shape and content for the country's political process. And it is important because it provides the framework for all political activities. And we can say that political culture is normally quite stable, and it changes slowly in normal conditions because the past affect the future through the political culture. A seminal work on political culture was Almond and Werber's study Civic Culture, published in 1963, which based on surveys conducted in the US, Great Britain, West Germany, Italy and Mexico. He found three poor types of political culture: parochial, subject-minded, and participatory. In parochial political culture, citizens are only weakly aware of the existence of the central government, like tribes in the periphery. In subject-minded political culture, the citizens perceive themselves rather as the object of rule than the participant of the political process. By contrast, in the participatory political culture, citizens perceive that they are both the object of the regime and are able to influence it. And this Almond and Werber proposed that liberal democracy will prove most stable in societies blending different cultures in a particle mix, which they called civic culture. The ideal conditions for democracy, they argued, emerge when an essentially participant political culture is balanced by attitudes leading to low level of political participation. A measure of passivity provides ballast for the political system, enabling it survive under periods of stress. In this way, the civic culture resolves the tension within democracy between popular control and effective government. It allows the citizen influence while retaining flexibility for government. On the countries under their study, Britain and to lesser extent also the US came closest to the ideal civic culture. In both countries, citizens felt that they could influence the government, but often choose not to do so, thus conferring on the government its required agility. In fact, Almond and Werber's ideal of civic culture have joint elements with so-called stealth democracy, which was proposed by Americans Hibbing and Stace Morse in the early 2000s. This concept comes from stealth aircraft such as B-2 bombers, which are difficult to see with standard radar techniques, but everybody knows that they exist. Research literature indicates that many post-industrial societies have experienced a withdrawal from the channels of conventional political activism. This transformation applies also to Finland, but with some important exceptions. There are in Finland elements of participatory political culture. Finns trust in the political and legal systems and other people was the highest among all EU member states in 2011. Moreover, Finns have participated in civic associations more than people in any other EU state. Close interplay between civic association and the government have reflected in the Finnish political culture as respect for law, peacefulness, trust in enlightenment, and lavish respect for formal organizations. However, in Finland there are also elements of subject-minded political culture. The voter turnout in Finnish general elections is within the lowest third of all Western democracies and has decreased more sharply than in many other countries, especially in Scandinavia. The voter turnout was 70 percent in last general elections in 2015. Moreover, Finns subjective civil competence, that is the sense that one can understand political processes and participate in them meaningfully, is at a much lower level than in Europe on average. Moreover, the general appreciation for of democracy is not very high, but at the same time, the sense of democratic deficit among Finns is one of the lowest in international comparison. Why this is the case? This is a result of that Finns' limited expectation from democracy. As far as stealth democracy is concerned, there are in Finland and in the US support among the elites and general population for the idea that political decisions should be made rather by experts and businessmen than politicians. The Finnish political system has been characterized by stability since the Second World War, despite major changes as industrialization, globalization, deep recessions in the early 1990s and from 2008 onwards. Especially with respect to foreign and security policy, stability has been a key value in Finland, and just in this current situation, it has been challenged by the annexation of Crimea to Russia. And one factor that have contributed to upholding regime legitimacy in Finland is this Finnish political culture, which combines a high level trust in the regime with low levels of political participation, a civil society that integrates the citizens with public authorities, and low belief in one's chances to have a say in political decisions. And just this combination can be called mix of participatory and subject-minded political country. And we can say that these distinctive features of Finnish political culture can have served as a buffer between changes in society and the elites, relieving the pressures of change on elites. And the key element of the Finnish political culture has been consensus, which has its roots in the independence struggle against Russia in the beginning of 20th century, later on in the year in the year 1987, when the Social Democrats and the Agrarians formed a cabinet coalition. And of course, finally in the era of Winter War. Since early 1980s, Finland has been ruled by multi-party majority cabinet coalitions, which have crossed the political left-right continuum. And one of the methods for maintaining political consensus has been embracing or taming of radical and populist political movements. This means that the communists were recruited to the government in 1944 and more permanently from 1966 onwards. And the populist rural party was represented in the government from 1983 to 1991, and its successor, the Finns Party, formerly it was called the True Finns Party, from 2015 onwards. And we can say that this process of embracing has been successful in that sense that the support for these both parties has decreased significantly. And the difference between Finland and, for example, Sweden and the Netherlands is important. The Finnish party is nowadays one of three cabinet parties in Finland with declining political support, while in Sweden and the Netherlands, other parties do want to isolate these populist political parties. They don't want to cooperate at all with populists. And we know that the support of these populist parties is increasing. And finally, as we all know, that the US and Finland are very different countries in many respects, for instance, size. And we may ask now, do they differ totally in terms of leadership? And my findings suggest that this is not the case. I published a book 2 years ago in United States, which was based on surveys conducted among Finnish elites since the early 1990s, where I analyzed the recruitment, coherence, and interaction networks of elites. And I compared the Finnish elites with American elites based on Michael Lynch's book, View from the Top. It was published in 2014. And he and his team interviewed 550 American elite members during 10 years, including presidents and CEOs and so on. And Michael Lynch depicts the American dream, the ability to come from nothing and to walk the way to the top of society. He describes that 3/5 of elite members were drawn from the middle class, and a significant minority grew up in homes where one or both parents were drawn from middle class. Actually, they were coming from blue-collar workers, blue-collar jobs. In Finland, in 2011, 1/3 of elite members were recruited from the highest social stratum. Another 1/3 came from middle class, while father was a farmer among 1/5 of elite members, and among the same proportion of elite members, he was a blue-collar worker. And virtually all elite members were graduated from the university in the US and Finland. However, an important difference is that in Finland, all universities are free of charge for students, which has contributed importantly to the upward social mobility among individuals with low social background. Although we often also assume that the most direct path to the top goes through major academic institutions such as Ivy League schools, according to Lynch, nearly 2/3 of American elite members attending schools that are not considered elite institutions. Even elite members' hobbies in their youth were very similar in both countries. Athletics, scouting, and student organizations were important hobbies. So there are many similarities. Lynch argues that there are in US many ways to be recruited to the elite, but all they require social networks. And this is also the case in Finland. Actually, it has been said that Finland is not a country, it is a club. So it's a very, very small country where every important people know each other. So networks are very tight. Now, French colleague Jean-Pascal Dalloz has described the expectations which concern the behavior of Scandinavian and Finnish elites. They are expected to avoid ostentation. This means that the lifestyle is expected to epitomize conspicuous modesty. And this is not the case, for instance, in France and many African states, but Lynch argues that this is the case in America. I was a little bit surprised that this was his conclusion. But there are one important difference between Finnish and American political culture. This consists horizontal elite circulation, and it's very topical theme because when Obama administration was replaced by Trump administration, thousands of leaders moved between the government, public administration, and so on. And in Finland, this has been very, not very common, but this circulation has increased also in Finland since the early 1990s. And finally, some thoughts about challenges. It seems evident that countries on both sides of the Atlantic are facing similar challenges in terms of top leadership. The gap between the elites and the people seems to widen, and people seems to be more clearly divided into insiders and outsiders, which is reflected as growing popular support for populism. And the reasons for this change are very well known: globalization, changing economic structures, automatization, vanishing blue-collar jobs that call for only minimal education. However, the social changes have concerned not only people with low education or uneducated people. We know that even academic education no longer ensures a permanent job and a respected social status. Upward social mobility is decreasing, while downward social mobility is increasing. Descendants of the middle class have more and more difficulties to attain their parents' income level and social status. They are living in uncertainty and want to regain control over their lives. The American dream seems to have blurred on both sides of the Atlantic. And all these factors, in addition to return of Cold War, terrorism, and the influx of refugees, increase challenges for transatlantic leadership. And we can say that meeting these challenges requires the maintenance of social cohesion. But how to reach this cohesion, it's a complicated question. Finally, we can ask that, is it better to integrate populists or isolate them? This is a quite important question today in Europe. Thank you.
Thank you, Ilkka. Well, there's so many questions that have been thrown up that are terribly important that I'm tempted to follow the Woodrow Wilson Center
clock at the back there, which is still running on Eastern Standard Time. And that would give us plenty of time for questions. Unfortunately, that would mean we wouldn't have our reception, and I suspect that civil society might break down, so I don't want that to happen. I'm going to arbitrarily cut our intra-panel discussion to a minimum so we can open it up to the audience. One thing, though, that I would like to ask, but everyone seems to agree that civil society, a strong civil society, is absolutely essential for democracy. And I think that's clear. But you know, civil society can be undercut. It's not a given that it will remain the same. Frankly, civility as such has declined in this country, the civility of discourse. Everyone comments on that. It's not nearly as civil a debate as we used to have. Or in other countries, I always think of Russia, that's my default. If the government, as Mr. Putin embodies, is afraid of so-called color revolutions, then he sets about, as he has done, emasculating civil society, banning civil society organizations, calling them agents of foreign powers. My only point is that maintaining civil society as a strong element of the country is a constant need. I mean, it needs to be tended. It can't just be assumed that it's going to remain that way forever. My heavens, all of you have brought up so many interesting questions. The size of the country is small, beautiful. I mean, we're comparing a country of 5.75 million with a country of 325 million. It's, I mean, just begin with that. It's just huge. Taming radical movements, yes, I think that Finland's done a good job, but it hasn't done a perfect job, and we could talk about that. I think it's you know, one thing to bring parties in, it's another thing to discipline party members who stray way off the reservation, and I, my own humble opinion, that has not been done sufficiently in Finland recently, but that's one person's opinion. And finally, I mean, I'll just close on this. This is a completely unscientific comment, but I mean it. The element of just luck is important. We talk about leadership. I've often thought about our founding fathers in the United States. And I know the founding, usually their fathers, maybe there are a few blessed countries that have founding mothers, but usually it's founding fathers. In every country are considered to be 8 feet tall and, you know, brilliant and all that. I think when you look at ours are probably about 7'6". I mean, it was the most remarkable collection of people that you could imagine. Now, how did that happen? Yeah, we had a few universities, very few. But then again, George Washington never went to one of them. And if the more I read and I look at Washington's life, the more awestruck I am by a man who had the wisdom. I mean, just an unbelievable prescience and wisdom. So universities, fine, but that alone can't explain it. Self-reliance, because the individual colonies were allowed essentially, in most of them, self-rule for 150 years. The British governor was more or less unobtrusive. That's possible. But I still think there is that intangible factor of having the right people at the right time. And Lord knows there have been enough countries who have not had the right people at the right time to lead them. And I just throw that out. I still have not come up with a better reason for the success of our founding fathers. But and then finally, the nexus between domestic insecurities and international events. That's really crucial. I mean, I think every successful foreign policy has to be grounded in domestic policy. But we know how leaders can manipulate the domestic scene with foreign adventurism. It's the oldest trick in the book. And I throw that out to you. I'm not going to go into, again, my favorite country to analyze is Russia. There's a political scientist named Pavel Bayev, who lives in Norway, who's written at great length about this, about the militarization of Russian society and the adventurism by Putin, because he doesn't want to reform his domestic setup for obvious reasons. But it's not unheard of in democracies. It's not unheard of in this country to have a more aggressive policy abroad to sort of cover up for deficiencies at home. We don't have a whole lot of time. Do any of you want to ask each other questions quickly, or should we turn to the audience? I believe in participatory democracy.
Could I just say one thing to what you referred to, and I think is very important because we all referred to it, that's civil society and the roots that it casts for the development of leadership. You know, if you measured age of a country in terms of years of independence, Finland is very, very young compared to the United States. But if you measure age in terms of traditions and values and practices of civil society, my heavens, Finland is almost as old as President Ahtisaari. No, what I mean is that it's much, much older than the United States. I think that the work that I've done on looking into the character of Finnish political leadership at a particular point in history reveals that kind of backbone.
I don't disagree with you about Finland, but let me just remind you of Alexis de Tocqueville's Democracy in America, who talked at great length in the 1830s about civil society here. So it's not, I mean, it was here too.
Maybe we've forgotten.
And someone brought up the need for better cooperation between the White House and Congress. I could talk about cooperation within Congress, but then we would certainly not have an appetite for the reception which will follow. Who would like to ask questions? Ah, now I see some hands. I see one here and one there, and yes, sir. Wait for the mic and tell us your name and your affiliation, please.
Stephen Shore, I'm with a federal agency, not wholly domestic, called the PBGC. My question is, in terms of the comparison of size between Finland and the United States, Finland is what Aristotle would call a polis in terms of its size and uniformity. The United States is more of an empire in a neutral sense. It's a coalition, international coalition of NATO, which is essentially, despite occasional American protest of reaching its members reaching the sacred 2%, is still American dominated. So is there a point where the size of a nation essentially ultimately leads to oligarchy and makes democracy impossible?
Now, that's what I meant when I said, is small beautiful. I mean, that's the flip side. Who'd like to handle that quickly?
Okay. I can say something. I think that the size is not very important factor, because that's true that Finland is a town compared to United States, but all the same political processes exist in a small country than in a large country. But that's true that in US the political process is much more complicated because you have many levels in your administration. US is a federal state. There are we can say that your states your 50 states can be compared, for instance, European states. That's the difference. But anyway, I think that all the political game is played quite similarly in small and bigger states.
Well, one difference, of course, between Finland and the United States is unicameralism versus bicameralism. Mm. And there's a famous story in terms of polity. In the late 1930s, a young congressman was elected from Texas, Lyndon Johnson, came to Washington as a firebrand, a new dealer. And the story is that he was, his first or second week in office, he was absolutely incensed by something that one of the Republicans had said on the floor of the House. And he went over to the office of the Speaker of the House, Sam Rayburn, who was his mentor, and he was just all upset, and he started ranting about our enemies, the Republicans. And Rayburn, who was a little guy, and Johnson was a big guy, so Rayburn looked up to him and said, "Lyndon, you're new around here. You have to understand, the Republicans are our opponents. The Senate's our enemy." Somebody out there, please. Yeah. I can sort of see you.
Yes, sir. My name is Cammy Bhatt. I'm with the Pakistani Spectator. And my question is about our current President Donald Trump's role in assuring European security. And I think the way he wants to achieve that goal is to end the Cold War in absolute terms with Russia. So my question is that during Cold War, European were longing to end the Cold War and live peacefully with USSR or Soviet Union. And now it's the time when Donald Trump wants to achieve that goal without any war, Cold War or hot war. Can he expect full cooperation of European, especially Finland, in order to achieve his goal of ending the Cold War or hot war in Europe by the help of Putin? Thanks.
Well, Jim, you're the obvious yes. man to handle that easy question.
I was going to say the only Finn here Please. Probably should answer that. But well, I don't think that the ending of the Cold War on the terms that Mr. Trump seems to be thinking about it right now is actually going to happen. The realities of what I think our president is facing in Congress tells you that there's going to be a fairly serious investigation of what's been happening in the cyber world. And therefore, I don't think that there's going to be a rush to embrace President Putin, as you might be thinking in your question. Would the Europeans support this? Well, obviously, they're quite concerned about things like the lifting of sanctions because of Ukraine. Chancellor Merkel, who was here a few days ago, obviously made clear to President Trump that she wants to continue these until there's been some change in Putin's attitude towards Ukraine. So I think there will be a lot of discussions, and I think the movement towards radical change will be fairly slow, which I think the Europeans would support.
Let me also add that Mr. Putin wants recognition of his country as an equal. But more than that, he wants to reestablish his sphere of influence, not only in the territory of the former Soviet Union, but also in places like the Balkans. Now, in December 2010, there was the last great international summit meeting of the OSCE in Astana, Kazakhstan. They came up with after hard negotiations, with the commemorative statement, and two of the things in the commemorative statement were, number one, every country has the right to choose its own means of defense, including its own membership in an alliance if it wants to, and number two, there will be no spheres of influence, of privileged spheres of influence in Europe. This was signed by all 57 participating states, including Dmitry Medvedev, the president at the time of the Russian Federation. Countries like Finland, I would submit, are passionate about holding to this, not the least reason. This is all part of the Helsinki process. Mm-hmm. But the smaller the country, the more important, as we've heard several times this afternoon, the more important adherence to the rule of law internationally, the more important it is. So my guess is that, as Ambassador Goodby just said, ending a Cold War, I mean, I would submit the Cold War has heated up in the last 5 years. It had actually had ended in 1991. You can call it neo-Cold War or Cold War II, whatever it is, but it has come back. And I don't think most of our European friends would like it to end on the terms that would divide up Europe again into spheres of influence and basically violate the kind of ideals that President Ahtisaari described earlier.
I might just add to that. I think the image of the Cold War gives a wrong impression of what we are looking at today, whether you want to look on today's relationship as a revival or a continuation of the Cold War. But the Cold War really did presuppose a bilateral relationship that, or I call it a condominium of power between the U.S. and the Soviet Union. Everything was tied up between those two great powers, and no one dared to move out of their clutches, which provided a great degree of stability, I might say, just in global terms. But today's relationships are much more complex, and it's not just a question, if we look at the U.S. and Russia, it's not just a question of agreeing on certain areas that we can't agree on and then agreeing to disagree. It's looking at those areas where, in fact, take the U.S. and Russia, do have common interests. And I take the Arctic as an example there, because that's not a strictly bilateral relationship, but the U.S. and Russia do share great common interest in economic security, environmental security, military security, human security. So that's an area that is not a negotiation and not a Cold War situation, but something where common security interests do need to be addressed.
Good point. Anyone else? You're all hungry for the... Oh, I didn't say, I could, yeah, that's all in the dark. Please go ahead. I'm sure you'll enlighten us, however.
Hi, my name is Mariette Hegelund. I'm a fellow at Johns Hopkins, also a Finn. I was wondering what small countries like Finland and other Nordic countries could, like, how they could translate their success into a more global relevance, to like what bigger role they could take in a global context.
Who would like to comment on that? Finland is, I mean, just existing as such a model as Kirsti Kauppi described, strikes me in itself magnifies Finland's influence, but maybe there are other ways.
Well, certainly in proactive ways, in terms of humanitarian intervention, in terms of peacekeeping, those kinds of structural and very obvious contributions, but also the kind of thing that Richard Hawes refers to in his book on the world in disarray, that nations have a sovereign obligation not to let bad things happen elsewhere. And I think the example that Finland gives in terms of being able not only to keep the stability and exemplary political behavior writ large going in the world is something that inspires other countries, small or large, to have trustworthy relations with, to have confidence in, and certainly while countries like Finland exist, it will not let bad things happen.
Let me give you one concrete example. I don't know what is happening even as we speak in the House of Representatives, but the vote is supposed to occur today. Those of you who've looked at, did it occur? It hasn't yet. On what we do about health care, our health care system. The vote, not the healthcare system. Okay. last Sunday, I think it was, I lose track of weeks, but in the Outlook section of the Washington Post, there was a lengthy article by a Finnish-born American woman named, I think, Anna Partanen, who came to the United States 7 years ago and who described the Finnish health system. And she also put health care into a OECD-wide context, 32 advanced industrial democracies. My sense was, having lived in Finland recently, that she was not exaggerating or making it pretty. She made, you know, a few mildly negative comments, but the thrust of the article was, in capitalist democracies, you can have a government-run system that preserves freedom, preserves a modicum, at least, of choice, is much cheaper than what we have, and at least it's worth looking at. I mean, I would urge you all to Google the article and look at it yourselves and come to your own conclusions. But there's a concrete example of how a small country, in this case Finland, in one tremendously important topical area today, can at least serve as an alternative model. I urge you to look at it. Mm. Well, I see people gathering at the door. It's now 3:57:52, which means 4:57 in daylight saving time. We've managed to wrap up in time. I think it's been a lot of fun. I hope it's been interesting for you all. Please join me in thanking our panelists.
Thank you.
Great job. Yeah.